Hi, this is George, and you're watching The Return of the King Channel. Chuck Missler labels the rapture Christianity's most preposterous belief. In the opening chapter of this book, he states, "Most people assume that the future is but a linear extrapolation of the present. Life will just go on. Our society adheres to views of uniformity and the eternity of nature, but the Bible says otherwise. A stunning event is coming, an event which cannot be denied by clever detractors or contradicted by coy pretenders. It may seem bizarre that in some indeterminate moment, true believers in Christ will be taken up, snatched literally out of this world, while the rest of humanity continues on living their lives on earth. In fact, the idea of a mass rapture is considered by many to be the most preposterous belief held by Christians. At the same time, it's the blessed hope of many Christians today that they might actually be part of a historical phenomenon, the likes of which the world has never seen." David Wilcock and other New Age personalities have been told by their angelic spirit guides that a great upheaval is coming to Earth, and that a selection of humanity will soon be taken off planet. David, speaking of himself, says this, "Little did I know that within a few years, my lucid dreaming research would plunge me into a world that seemed completely supernatural by most people's standards. I would eventually come into direct contact with angelic, human-looking, extraterrestrial beings who helped me completely re-envision science and spirit into a new and greater unified whole. They proved over and over again that they could predict the future as easily as if they were reading a book, and they would soon pass along the greatest message of all, namely, that we are right on the threshold of a spectacular mass evolutionary event many have called ascension. These angelic beings also reveal that the only way to prepare ourselves for this mass awakening is to be genuinely dedicated to following a path of service to others, practicing forgiveness, compassion, patience, love and understanding in our daily lives as our primary motivation." His last statement sounds very much like Galatians 5, 22 and 23. "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law." The one common thread found in all contact with these beings is they endorse every religion except Christianity. They never acknowledge who Jesus is, the Son of God. And no wonder, for even Satan disguises himself as an angel of light. In his book, Wilcock covers the remote viewing experiences of social scientist Dr. Brown. Dr. Brown was trained by the military in remote viewing. To start the session, the remote viewer goes into a meditative trance-like state. He is assisted by a guide that tells the viewer where to go and what to do. The guide is given coordinates, and the remote viewer has to describe the target location. They are given a number of known targets. Intermixed are unknown targets or locations. The best remote viewers have a 99% success rate in describing known targets or locations. If the remote viewer can accurately describe known locations, then it can be assumed that the viewing of the unknown locations is also accurate. For example, they will be given a known address. If the viewer can correctly describe what he sees at the location, then they know the remote viewer is in sync, so to speak, with those entities who are feeding him the information. What David Wilcock and Dr. Brown do not understand is they are being deceived by intelligent evil. When the remote viewer is given a known location, the information being given to them by these beings is truthful. But when they go to a location unknown, for example, a location on Mars, the beings can say whatever they want, and they do. They lie to keep the truth hidden. These divine beings, fallen angels, and demons possess an understanding of the coming judgment, and their deception is remarkably sophisticated. In their manipulation of biblical truths, the necessity of the blood of Christ for salvation becomes unnecessary. Those who fall for this mass deception will be lost for eternity. Nick Redfern, in his book Final Events, explains the dark forces behind remote viewing. Our story begins when two Department of Defense physicists recruit Anglican priest Ray Boucher, who was also the former director for the Mutual UFO Network of Nebraska. He's recruited for projects involving NHEs, non-human entities. It turns out that both of the physicists are also Christians. After working with these non-human entities, they came to this conclusion. They came to believe that the non-human entities were not extraterrestrial at all. They believed they were some sort of demonic entities, and that regardless of how benevolent or beneficial any of the contact they had with these entities seemed to be, it always ended up being tainted, for lack of a better term, with something that ultimately turned out to be bad. There was ultimately nothing positive from the interaction with the non-human entities. They felt it really fell more under the category of some vast spiritual deception instead of UFOs and aliens. In the course of the whole discussion, it was clear that they really viewed this as having a demonic origin that was there to simply try and confuse the issue in terms of who they were, what they wanted, and what the source of the ultimate truth is. If you extrapolate from their take that these are demons in the biblical sense of the word, then what they would be doing here is trying to create a spiritual deception to fool as many people as possible. Nick Redfern goes on to say this, "While contact was apparently wholly successful, as were the attempts to use the mental powers of the non-human entities, Boucher said the two physicists believed that those in the DOD working on this project were being utterly deceived and lulled into a false sense of security. They thought that the project personnel were allowed to assume that they had somehow technologically mastered the ability to do what the non-human entities could do, remote viewing and psychotronics. But in actuality, it was these entities doing it all the time, or allowing it to happen, for purposes that suited their deception. With both psychotronic weapons and remote viewing, I was told that the DOD had not really mastered a technology to do that at all. They were allowed by the non-human entities to think that this is what they had done, but the non-human entities were always the ones responsible." Now understanding what's behind the true dynamics of a remote viewing session, let's look at what these entities led Dr. Brown to believe about imminent end times events approaching Earth. This vision of the future was shown to him in two remote viewing sessions. The first session occurred on February 9, 1994. In his remote viewing session, he perceived himself entering a towering structure that had energetic, bright, white, blue, and yellow lights. He noticed an energy vortex encircling a round object in the center of the room, which he feels may have been a planet or at least a holographic projection of such an image. He could smell ammonia in the air. The many beings in this facility were all bald, humanoid, and wore white gowns. It felt like a Zen monastery, and they all communicated both verbally and telepathically. Dr. Brown was welcomed by a president or prime minister of this group and was told that human representation from Earth on the Council was now to begin. Dr. Brown was shown an image of our Milky Way galaxy, divided up into sections with dotted lines. He was told that this federation did need our help in a galactic sense. Specifically, Dr. Brown said, "I am being told that there will be a movement off the planet in the future for humans. Earth humans are violent and troublesome currently. They need shaping before a later merger. Definitely, humans need to undergo some sort of change before extending far off the planet. There definitely will be a planetary disaster, or perhaps I should say disasters. There will be political chaos, turbulence, an unraveling of the current political order." David Wilcock, commenting on these words from Dr. Brown, says this, "Dr. Brown's words from his 1996 book are certainly prophetic as I write these words in 2019. We are most definitely seeing political chaos, turbulence, and an unraveling of the current political order in a way that would have seemed unimaginable back when his words were written. Nothing about this idea of an upcoming catastrophe was upsetting or frightening to me, because by this point I had experienced over 3 years' worth of dreams encouraging me to see such an event as a multidimensional evolution of what it means to be human." Dr. Brown, on March 10, 1994, does another remote viewing session that gives a more detailed account of what he sees on this planet in the Pleiades star system. He sees beings in the sky near a very bright light and beings on the ground. the beings in the sky are more advanced than the beings on the ground. Looking at the people on the surface, Dr. Brown says the following. Focusing on the ground for now, there is dirt, grass, and humans wearing normal, American-style casual clothing. Let me check that out. Yep, pants, socks, shoes, the works. The humans are quite upset. There's a lot of fear here, plus crying. He then tries to tap into when this will occur. He saw that it was slightly after the year 2000. Slightly after the year 2000 could easily extend as far as the year 2030. He then goes on to explain that it's the job of the aliens, known as Greys, to facilitate the transfer of beings, in this case, humans, to another planet. Later in the session, the Greys contacted Dr. Brown directly. They tell him that the people on this new world are from Earth. They, the Greys, brought them here. They have been transplanted. Dr. Brown asked them why this happened. Their response was that human survival was at stake. A new location is needed away from Earth's climactic disasters. After the remote viewing sessions completed, Dr. Brown made this comment. It seems that some humans will be space lifted to a safe haven, while the rest of humanity slugs it out back home. This is now David Wilcock's commentary on Dr. Brown. This was literally identical to the ascension scenario I had already been studying and meditating on. It was quite surprising that Dr. Brown was presenting this as raw data, without seeming to understand any of the backstory behind it, that I had already been researching. The transfer Dr. Brown was seeing may well have been describing what would happen to those people who were not really ascending, but just needed to be moved to a safe place once the Earth went through its upheavals. This exact same concept would appear only weeks later when I read the Law of One. The people who graduate into fourth density and this apparently multidimensional event do get to remain on Earth as it transforms into a fourth density planet. What David Wilcock is saying, he's saying that people who are resisting this move to a higher level of consciousness, Christians, for example, will be taken off the planet. Those left behind will fight against the forces of evil, the dark demonic forces that inhabit the universe. They, the ones left on Earth, will be victorious over evil and will ascend to the next level of consciousness. And the world will live as one, in peace and harmony, so they've been told. The truth versus the deception. The deception. Humans will be taken from Earth and relocated on a new planet. The truth. At the rapture, humans will be taken from Earth and relocated to heaven for 7 years. The deception. The left behind are the ones who will ascend to the next level. The truth. At the rapture, we will undergo a physical transformation. The mortal puts on the immortal. Behold, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed, in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. For this perishable body must put on the imperishable, and this mortal body must put on immortality. When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written, Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The deception. The left behind are the ones who will defeat evil and usher in the age of Aquarius. The truth. We return with Christ and the armies of heaven, and in one final battle, defeat all the enemies of God. We will then rule and reign with Christ for 1,000 years. Our time on Earth is coming to an end. Curious about just how soon? Check out the link for more details. I appreciate your time and thanks for watching.